is when you lose an experienced player of Gethin's ability. I think that we're really fortunate. Obviously, he is going to be missed, but in terms of the leadership group, obviously we can replace Geth in the leadership group. Also, in terms of the strength and depth in the loose head, obviously welcoming back Rob Evans, obviously missed out in the autumn. But Nicky Smith's improvement in the autumn, played really well, hugely competitive. And they've got an opportunity between those two and Rodri as well. Obviously he's looked at the tight head more so. But I think those two players will bring a lot of competition. And Gethin, at the moment, I'm not too sure how long he's going to be out for. But we felt that at the time that he was going to be out, it was no point naming him in the squad. So we'll take a decision when that comes, to be honest, Mark. There was a huge focus going into the autumn series on skills. Obviously, conditioning players with the ball in particular, and we'll continue with that sort of sort of best practice. I think that when everyone talks about the autumn, you know, the first game was not acceptable in terms of our performance, but we recovered, and in adversity, we went on to win the three games. And I think that you're damned if you do and damned if you don't sometimes in terms of performance and winning. The Welsh side over the last 8-9 years, sometimes we've come up short in terms of winning games and we've been criticised. I think in the autumn we've got over the line and won three games, and the players can be applauded for that. But after the South Africa game, we said in the change rooms that it's another level that we need to go to, and that level will need to come in the Six Nations. And I was hugely excited coming into the Six Nations on Monday. There's a freshness about the squad. There's an excitement. And we've got a new captain. And that changes dynamics. You know, Sam Warburton has been a fantastic leader, has led Wales from the front. And, you know, as I mentioned earlier about Sam, that he needs to focus on his own game. There's a lot of competition in the back row. And no doubt he will go away and do that. But obviously delighted to have someone with the presence of Alan Wynne, 105 caps, captain Wales before, led the Lions in the third test, and he'll certainly lead us with his actions and motivation, and looking forward to working with him. That selection process will happen over the period of time of the 8 weeks. I think we're all mindful as well in terms of performances for club and region are really important. We're also mindful that there's, you know, a huge step up. That step up in terms of training, in terms of intensity, and that's a challenge for those players. And I think that, in particularly in the back row, you know, and on, you know, the wings, there is competition for places, and it's good to see because that's what every international coach wants. I think we've got a wonderful player in Dan Biggar, experience. I think in terms of the strength and depth with Sam and Owen, playing particularly well. It's an ingredient which we wanted and have had in the past. I think we're fortunate to have those three tens. Obviously, Owen's got the ability to play 12 as well, which might be key in the championship. But, you know, Dan's pretty experienced, but there's no doubt... you know, Sam's, you know, I think Dan is looking over his shoulder, which is good. And I think that will certainly, they're both helping each other. And I think that when you look at the Ospreys model in terms of the two tens, I think they're bringing the best out of each other. I'm sure Alan Will can speak, obviously playing with those players week in, week out, but they certainly bring the best out of each other. And it's great to see. And there's certainly a competitive edge when they're in training in the national team. And I'm sure that's week in, week out. They're used to that competitive edge in the regional game. I think there's a nice edge about Owen and a skill set. I've spoken to Aaron Major at length last week, before and after we named the squad, to get an insight into Owen. Obviously, I was an admirer when he played for Llanelli Scarlets, when he went to Leicester then. Obviously, sometimes he's been with a couple of injuries has stopped him playing, but his ability to play 12 and 10, you know, will be an asset for us over an eight-week period.
How do you assess Reece Webb's performance last week?
Yeah, nice dummy and score a try for the first try, wasn't it? I think that, look, Reece has got this knack of coming back quite quickly from injuries and delighted, you know, he's a player with a lot of experience. Because of those injuries, he's faced adversity many, many times in his rugby career, and he's almost bounced back in a positive frame of mind. He's been brilliant in the last 48 hours, coming back from Newcastle. We're going to release him on the weekend. He's going to play for the Ospreys. We've got a great working relationship with Steve Tandy. Rodri's going to be released as well. So game time for those two players. Game time for Reece is going to be important. And we'll take a decision then in terms of whether we feel that he's ready or not for that Italy trip, and we'll take selection next Monday or Tuesday. I think Alan Wynne might be able to answer that question in terms of impact. Certainly from my experience with Kingy, as I said earlier, when you look at his coaching CV, his pedigree of coaching, he's 6-7 years with Joe Smith and Vern Cotter. I know he spoke to both coaches before taking the role. He's been with Northampton for 3 years coaching, you know, a top Premiership side. And, you know, obviously knowing Kingy really well, having played with him, his attention to detail, he's an intelligent rugby player, he's an intelligent rugby coach, and he'll add value to our environment, and looking forward to working with him. An added benefit that he's very friendly with Sean Edwards, which almost helps. So I think that, you know, the one thing within our tight-knit coaching team, which obviously, you know, going into the Six Nations is a lot of trust and integrity, and Kingy certainly adds to that.
What does it mean to you, Alan, to be captain of Wales? Just give us a flavour of what that feels like.
I think, well, before I was captain, or the captain, with the label, the C, whatever, essentially that's all what it is. I was a player. Before I was a player, I was a fan. So a fan of the game, fan of the team. I'm just very fortunate now to be another part of this team as a player, and hopefully ready and able to make the decisions as a captain when needed. If we can grow some more leaders within the team that we have, and get to a point where the group of leaders, decision makers, off field and on field, are getting to the point where we're making similar decisions without potentially having to consult each other, then, as a case for me, that's job done. As in, not job done as in we're finished. It's a case of job done, let's move on to the next thing, next challenge, as a group and a team.
Was it something you always aspired to?
No, not at all. I think, as I said, I was a fan of the game, watching the Six Nations, Five Nations, as a kid. I'm very fortunate that I've been able to pull the red jersey on a few times. And now I'm able to assist the team, assist the young players coming through, other guys who potentially do have ambition to play more for Wales. And, you know, that's a very fulfilling and big opportunity for myself and, again, the team.
Have you had much in the way of conversations with Sam about the way he did it, the way you might intend to do it? Any discussions about the captaincy as well?
No, I think the graciousness that Sam's displayed has been good. I think we've had a brief conversation. You know, congratulations, as expected. But hopefully we've been a credit in the fact that it shouldn't be about us. It should be about the team moving forward. It's not about two of the 36. It's about the 36 who are going to go into this competition with an attitude to perform to try and get results, like Rob said.
Have you ever noticed a tangible difference between the Six Nations played before, Alliance Series and one, perhaps just stand alone?
No, I think there's a lot more questions about it for obvious reasons, but I think from a player's perspective, it's, you know, again, apologies to answer the question with a similar answer I said earlier. I think the easy answer would be to say, you know, from a player point of view, no one's thinking about it. You know, there are probably players with ambitions, and that's a very good thing. As long as they can bury that down and maintain the focus on the team that they're in, then we'll be in a good place.
Does being the permanent world's captain now, from a personal perspective, as far as the Lions are concerned, make that easier? Because, you know, almost the distraction of being the full-time captain?
No. I think, like I say, I'm a player first. If I'm not playing well, I'm still hopefully available to be deselected. If that's not the case, I wouldn't have accepted the role as captain. Because I think, like, I'm not there today. I wasn't there yesterday afternoon, so I've got to be comfortable in the people that I'm around, that they're going to be fine. There's going to be occasions where potentially this is going to happen more often, or whatever, or injury, or, you know, these are all the eventualities we have. But like I say, if we get to the point where we're all on the same hymn sheet, pardon the cliche, then we're in a good place. And you know, it's a pretty simple aspect from my point of view, because ultimately I've got to be playing well to even be considered in that role. So I'm very, very conscious of that.
Some people thrive on captaincy. Would you say you're one of
them? I don't know. I don't know if it's added pressure either. I think I've done it at a domestic level for a while now, through a couple of tough times. You know, I'm not ashamed to say that, but I've enjoyed the challenge of it. Obviously, it's elevated to somewhat at a national level, but time will tell.
And in terms of getting people to follow you, is that just government-wide, main-wide?
Well, I don't really want followers, to be honest with you. You know, that's what Twitter's for. I want people that want to be led, and then eventually can make their own decisions and, you know, look after their own departments.
Well, in relation to the bonus points, we hope so. I think that sides might have an intent to play in the last 20 odd minutes of the game. I think that listening to Roy Best earlier, he's probably spot on that we go into the game in terms of the high pressure occasion, and the history and the legacy of the RBS Six Nations is about winning the game. They're big games to win, and big games then have momentum changes, but there's no doubt that there will be maybe a mindset shift in terms of the last 20 minutes if you find yourself, you know, near a bonus point opportunity. There's no doubt that, you know, spoke earlier about the high tackle. Rugby has almost been about low tackling, but you know, the game has evolved and defensive alignments and defensive coaches have coached the choke tackle in terms of going high and stopping offloading game. I suppose certainly it might open it up in terms of a very more offloading game, but in terms of any high shots, it's the, we got Nigel Owens coming in on Saturday with us to give us a sort of presentation. They're meeting on Thursday, IRB referees. So Nigel's coming in to referee a game with us, and then he's going to give us a sort of presentation and feedback what's discussed on Thursday with the IRB referees, which will be a great insight, and I'm sure the high tackle will be mentioned. I'm sure players and supporters and coaches, we don't want Six Nations games turned on red cards, and it's the empathy of those contacts, and whether it's reckless or not will be a key determinant whether it's yellow or red. No doubt when laws change, there's going to be a transition period of time, isn't it? How long that transition is, I suppose it's down to the diligence of the referees and the empathy, which obviously the referees are going to view that contact or that tackle. And, you know, how often we're going to see reviews with the TMO, which we'll just have to wait and see. But I wouldn't like to think that, you know, red cards are going to be a determinant of who's going to win the Six Nations Championship. Well, particularly our mindset playing at the Principality Stadium, we believe that we can beat anyone at home. It's something which we're really proud of in terms of playing at the Principality Stadium. We've got the best supporters and they certainly give us an edge. It's important that we actually bring our crowd into the game, something which we didn't do in the first game against Australia, which is hugely disappointing. Home advantage is an advantage, and you have to make sure in the Six Nations you front up at home, and we've only got two home games, but the two home games we've got against the second and fourth in the world. And there's an important draw on May the 10th, which have a huge influence on the landscape of our rugby over the next 4 years.
Is the roof part of that? You want the roof closed for both those occasions. Is the roof part of that experience, the noise, the kind of claustrophobic feeling?
Yes, but I was told yesterday that obviously the decision basically who's going to be open. That decision is not going to change. It's something which we wanted to sort of have because of the experience, one of the atmosphere, but also in terms of controlling the conditions. But that's not the case. We understand and we respect that decision.
So does that mean you come from?
Pardon?
Where did that decision
come from? RBS Six Nations.
And that was just their choice? Because England said they didn't seem to mind.
No, well, I think that's what we were. I was told last night. So basically, it's now a discussion the week of the game, like it's always happened. You know, let's go back to 2013. Stuart Lancaster rang me on the Monday. I wanted the roof closed. If that's the case, when England come to Principality and Eddie Jones wants the roof closed, that's fine. So it's down to the opposition coach who will dictate whether the roof is open or closed.
It's just that he doesn't mind, so I guess it might come to you.
Well, happy days.